Good morning and welcome to the Sunrise Safari. It's Brent and Brian, the killer bees and the thumb. And we are with Shongile and Hosana. They are having the biggest game. Oh, there they go. We can't really see them. They're chasing. See it, Brian? Looks like little Shongile. You got her? She's right. She's going to come out to the right now. Here we go. They are chasing each other around with gay abandon at the moment. Jumping, leaping, tackling. But they are doing it on the southern side of this little river system, which is making it a little bit difficult for us to see them. But we are going to play the patience game here. We are live with two tiny little leopard cubs named Hosana, the little prince, and Shongile, the exquisitely beautiful one. And these are our dominant female leopard Karula's cubs. Oh, there we go. I see some tail movement, some wrestling. There we go. And the other is just below that one. So get ready for a pounce. Now, as I said, we're live. And if you want to ask any questions, it's questions@wildearth.tv on email or #SafariLive at Twitter. There we go. Oh, actually running towards us. Hello, little monster. And of course, we have... Oh! We have Jamie and Dangerous Dave out in the other vehicle. And James is hopefully going to be out on foot shortly. We are having a few technical difficulties with the bush backpack, the walk backpack. And this is very, very exciting and wonderful. Look at this. Where they're now. So they're just disappearing behind the bush now. And if we listen to the dawn chorus around us, one of my favorite calls in the early morning, we can hear in the distance. I don't know, if Brian, if you guys can hear that. That eagle owl. Ooh, ooh, ooh. Of course, it stops calling now. Now, fortunately, these cubs are big enough now, but a month or two ago, they would have made a decent meal for that eagle owl. The giant or Varroa eagle owl. Oh, I can see some movement at the back there. So we don't want to move around too much. I'm pretty sure they'll dart back into frame at some point. And I'm really hoping Queen Karula comes back with it. With a kill and hopefully a kill on Juma. You can actually hear them in the undergrowth. Oh, I can just, you see them? Yeah, you've got them there. So it's climbed up a little tree. Big game's happening there. It's chasing its own tail. Isn't that amazing? Now, all this chasing around, even chasing your own tail, is going to be important. It's all honing hunting skills. Oh, up the tree. What do you think, Brian? If we go back, we might get a bit of view. I think we're in the spot at the moment.
Now it's climbing to the tree.
Okay, let's just try move slightly. I'm going to try a little bit forward first. But I think back's the better option. So, while we try get the best view of Karula's little beauties, let's go say good morning to Jamie.
Good Good morning, and what a spectacular start to your sunrise at safari. You've got an extraordinary view of little cubs playing from Brent, and this really truly beautiful view of Sydney's dam on a chilly winter's morning with one old giraffe gentleman approaching the water. Look at this. Ah, oh, this is just my favourite time to be out in the bush. Ooh, with alarm calling guinea fowl. That's very interesting. Just an opportunity to take in the noises of the morning and the view. But yes, good morning. Probably introduce myself. My name is Jamie, and while Brent's been looking for leopard cubs, we've been on the search for lion cubs. I have dazzling Dave on camera with me, who is a very talented cameraman and not to be objectified in any way, shape or form.
Thank you, Jamie.
It's a pleasure, Dave. Oh, our giraffe's going to have a drink. Let's watch him quickly. Oh. Well, that was the quickest drink in the history of giraffe drinks. Obviously, that wasn't a good spot. There we go. There's a slightly better spot. Looking up nervously, I wonder what upset those guinea fowl. Something was causing the call that they were making. There we go. Trying to find a good spot to have one's morning drink is somewhat difficult at times. However, from one spotted animal to two much smaller spotted animals, let's go back to Brent and not miss out on one moment with those wonderful cubs.
Oh, Karula! Karula's just arrived. She just popped up right behind Brian. Oh, we're going to see a greeting ceremony. This is going to be exciting. Hopefully that is Karula. No, it is Karula. I'm pretty sure it's Karula. If it was another leopard, it'd be a bit of a problem. I just suddenly got this tap on my back from Brian. So we've had our back to the road. She obviously walked down the road right behind us, and we've been so focused on the cubs. You can hear her calling them. I'm just going to move the vehicle back a little bit. Let's go. Here we go, there she is. Going up to them. They're being naughty. Oh, there we go. They're responding to her. Here we go. Look at that. Hi, Mom. I missed you. So one has come to say hello. Where's the other? Oh, there we go. Hi, Mom. Can you see two or one, Brian?
Only one.
Only one. So Brian's a bit higher than me, and I'm just watching in the monitor. Unfortunately, they are on the southern side of that little river system. But we're going to stand by here. She came in from behind us, so maybe she's got a kill behind us. So we're going to watch to see if she takes them off. Now we might have to do some maneuvering to get to the other side. Now Keith's asking, how long Can Karula be away from the cubs before it becomes dangerous? Well, Keith, it's always safer. It's always safer when she's around. But from a hunger point of view, it's probably about five to six days before it becomes a real issue. Now, I've lost sight of her. I'm going to try to get onto the slightly higher ground here. And I think I might try to find a way through the river system. Can you see anything, Brian? Okay. I need to make a plan now. Okay. So I'm going to have to go through this river system. It's going to be bad signal till I get through to the other side. So I think what I'm going to do is I'm going to try to get through to Karula. So while we do that, let's go back across.
And what marvelous news and what wonderful timing to arrive just as Mom got home and returned to the cubs to go and fetch them and hopefully, fingers crossed, take them to get some breakfast. After 2 days spent playing in one place, I imagine they are feeling rather hungry at this point. While Brent attempts to relocate him, and what I will do is I will offer to help Brent if he needs help, if he thinks that he needs help, then we will be on call and he can contact us on the Game Drive channel if he wants to get hold of us. We've left Sydney's Dam and we are cruising along down the northern boundary of Juma, which is the Buffalo's Hook cut line. Now, I did see tracks of an enormous... Stand by, sorry. I'll finish that sentence in a moment. Okay, it's not as fresh as I thought they were. It's a set of leopard tracks crossing the road, but they have been obliterated to the point that I don't even think you'll be able to see them all that clearly. No, I don't think it's worth looking at. Right, I did see tracks of an enormous herd of buffalo that wandered through Juma and probably towards Zoe's Road. What that means is there is a very, very good chance that our lion pride might have been following behind. So the Nkuhumas lost their buffalo kill, or abandoned their buffalo kill, to the hyenas. Which makes sense when you think that they had two or three very vulnerable little cubs with them feeding off that carcass. It just wasn't worth the risk for them to try and defend it. So they abandoned their buffalo and they have since moved on. But with at least two, probably three new moms, chances are they will be very much on the hunt for something else to eat. So that's what our plan is. And if we're successful, depending on what happens, we might head across to Cheetah Plains. Because I'm feeling as though it's been a very long time since we've seen a cheetah. And it might be time to rectify that. And good morning to Blue Butterfrog as we slowly make our way, hopefully to follow up on those lion cubs. And actually, that reminds me, I'm going to tell you a story in a moment. But Blue Butterfrog wanted to know, as our cubs start to get older, whether they be lions or leopards, or is there a chance that they, when they're playing with each other, they might actually fight and injure each other? They're tougher than you think, and their games tend to look to us to be unbelievably rough, but they are in fact well under control. They might scratch each other, there might be a couple of cuts and bruises, but it's all part of the learning experience. And there's no, as far as I know, there's no major recorded cases of siblicide in big cats. So it's very, very seldom that they do each other serious harm. Maybe with older cousins, especially with the lions, obviously, because that doesn't apply to leopards. But with the lions, older cousins might inflict a bit more damage. believe this is... There's leopard tracks again here. But they are actually relatively old. I don't know how we missed them. Unless it's just the road that's making them look older than they are. Oh, and I said you had to remind me to tell you a story. James bounced out of his room this morning and said to me, you've got to go and see the cubbies. So obviously he's a little bit won over by the brand new Nkuhuma cubs. He was positively bouncing. That might also have been to do with the cold though. I'm slowing down a little bit. There's lion tracks around here. And the question is, where have they gone? Have they moved through this area? It's amazing recently how much time we've actually spent on the northern boundary of Juma, just in terms of looking for lions, and they've been using this as a highway. I think that the presence of the cubs have been a huge factor in terms of reducing the amount of movement that all of the pride members have, or the amount of territory that they have utilized over the last few weeks. They've been sort of stuck in the same place, and that applies even to... That applies even to a situation where a lioness doesn't have cubs. Sorry, I'm just listening to the game drive comms at the same time and looking for lion tracks. And the lion tracks go in here. They are big male tracks. I'll show you what I mean. There we go. And these are relatively fresh, and I say that because they would not exist if they were not relatively fresh. And there's a couple of them here. Hold on, I need to remove my hot water bottle from my jacket, which is cheating. What did you call it, Dave? Packing heat with my hot water bottle underneath my jacket. Okay. So we've got a whole set of tracks. Some are older. What I was saying about Buffalo's Hook Cut Line being a highway for lions applies pretty much all the time. So what that leaves us with is tracks like this one, which is blurry and indistinct and barely a track at all. And then tracks like these. Can you see these ones here, Dave? I know the light's not ideal. Okay. And these tracks, the fact that you can see these tracks at all in the middle of this road. That was the worst drawn track in the world. And positively appalling. It looks like a Picasso interpretation of a lion track. Here's the other one here. So just by the size of the toes and the size of the track, our male lions have been paying us a visit. Here's another Picasso interpretation of the track. Let's go and find them. I think we'll go check. What we'll do is we'll go and check up on the den site of those little cubs first, and then we'll move down south and see if we can't find any of them around there. Okay, hold on everybody. All my cabling has to be redone. There we go. Right. Let's go and find some lions, Dave. Don't like the cold, okay? Here we go. My flower, bright pink hot water bottle. Brent has one too, just by the way. And it's equally bright pink and equally florally. And good morning and welcome, a very special welcome to M. Dean, who is a new viewer. And it's very special to have you on board. Don't forget, we do this twice a day, every day, for in our morning and afternoon. Oh, you wanted to know where exactly we are. We are up in the top northeastern corner of South Africa. So, MD, I don't know if you've ever heard of the world-famous Kruger National Park. That's about 4 miles that way, or close to 8 kilometers, depending on which particular system you use. So straight into the east of us. And we are part of a place called the Sabi Sand, which is open up into Kruger. So it's got no fences between us and them. And more specifically, we are on Juma, Arethusa, and Cheetah Plains game reserves in the Sabi Sand. So that might give you a little bit of an idea, or better idea, as to where we are. Essentially a place that is world famous for leopard and big cat sightings to start with. But just in general, a conservation area that has existed, not unchanged, but certainly protected for decades. And a very, very popular part of the country for international and local tourists alike. And we are fortunate enough to be driving around bringing you the stories of, oh my goodness, that's cold. Going downhill is very cold. It is, of course, midwinter here in South Africa. I'm very fortunate to be able to drive around and bring you the stories that we bring you in terms of our different animal characters. I know that Brent is furiously trying to follow up on Karula to try and find her. Fingers crossed they manage. And fingers crossed she's made a kill, first of all, but second of all that she's made a kill on Juma so that she doesn't disappear off with the cubs. And the wonderful news is as the sun starts to rise, it's the perfect time to go for a little stroll through the bush. And Mr. Henry is out and about doing just that. Let us find out what he's up to.
Good morning. Good morning, everybody. And I do apologise for our tardy start this morning. Unfortunately, not our fault. We have been making some modifications to the bushwalk backpack. I say we, I of course do not mean me in any shape, way or form, because it would have exploded if I tried to do anything to it. Quite a chilly morning today, but very pleasant out. I am just appreciating the applicity of the sun on my face. Jandre is on camera today. Hello, Jandre. Jandre says hello, everybody. He still hasn't washed his hair, which is disturbing, especially as we're going to make him walk very far today, and there will therefore be consequent sweating. Excellent start to the morning with all those little cubs, and hopefully Jamie too will see the tiny little... I lie on cubs then! I'm unable to say that little phrase without becoming totally overawed. We're as live as Jamie and Brent, so please talk to us, hashtag Safari Live, or questions at wildearth.tv, and I'm going to quickly introduce you to Herbert, who is over there. There's Herbert, and Herbert is on security detail and tracking today. He also provides us with some astoundingly wonderful information regarding the medicinal uses and traditional uses of the plants out here. That's because his mum, if I'm not mistaken, is a Sangoma, correct? Aunt, your aunt. His aunt is a Sangoma, and a Sangoma is a traditional healer or a herbalist in this particular area. So we've got some wonderful information there. I'm standing on a termite mound because I like apricity, and because I also like standing on a termite mound. We are now going to head down the termite mound without trying to fall off, and then we'll see what else we can find. Susie, you're in North Carolina, and you would like to know about the tortoises and turtles and where they've gone. No turtles here, Susie. We do have terrapins, though, and they are the freshwater turtles, and they're still in the water. And we saw some the other day sitting on Bob the Bachelor of Biffle's Hook's back. That's a lot of bees, Jandre. Were you impressed there so early in the morning? He's a hippopotamus that sometimes frequents the Biffle's Hook Dam, and there are the terrapins do come out and sit on his back and warm themselves in the sun. Most of the tortoises are underground, and we saw last walk-in was about 3 days ago, we saw a Speke's hinge tortoise in a termite mound, much like the one I was standing on there, and they burrow into a termite mound and kind of try and get the termite mound to collapse around them, and then they stay safe from predators for the dry season. And that is a process called aestivation. All right, Andre, shall we carry on our little walk?
Look.
Our plan this morning, everyone, is to head sort of to the north. We're going to go via towards what we call Aubrey's Road. We'll probably go past the old hyena den there and then turn down towards the south, coming down the western fringes of Juma. We don't know what we're going to find. We might be lucky. And as I'm sure Jamie and Brent have said, you never really know what's going to be around the next corner, behind the next bush. And because we don't know what's going to be behind the next bush, that's why we've got Herbert with us, keeping an eye behind all of the bushes. Now, if you look at the ground here, you see this, Jandre. You see I'm making pretty dust for you.
Yeah.
Yes, you're making very artistic shots there.
Yeah.
He says he isn't.
But it's not
art. Yes. You can see there is nothing here to eat. Very little in the way of grass. But as soon as the rains come, and let's hope that they do come, this will explode into green life. And that's because there's a very strong seed bed. So if we look down here, oh, there's a cloud covering the sun. That's not good for my apricity. Underneath the soil here are millions and millions of grass seeds. And all that is they're waiting for is a bit of water. And so we hope that by November, this dry soil, dusty soil, will be moist and it will also be verdant green. Let's go across to Brent Leo Smith and find out how his search for the great queen and the family of Windsor is going.
So you're not going to believe what on Karula's heels. Denmark in from where she's come from, which means she might have a kill somewhere else. So what has happened, she just took off with those cubs. We could barely see her, so we've taken a big route out of there, and we're checking an hour along the southern boundary in case she sprinted all the way south with the cubs. But I think she's probably got a kill to the east. So she might do a big loop like that to try lose the hyenas. So those hyenas came in with their noses to the ground, smelling each of her tracks. And she spotted them from 50, 60 meters away and then just took off. Now, that is not uncommon, and that's one of the biggest threats leopards face out here. And hyenas will often get onto a leopard track, especially if it's very fresh. And if she has made a kill, they might, with their incredible sense of smell, might be able to pick up stuff that fight a slight taint of blood or whatnot, and then follow her tracks. Hyenas are the most incredible opportunists out here. I mean, all the predators are opportunists, but I think none so are more opportunistic than the spotted hyena. I'm just going to switch off the car as we roll down the road here. Now remember, little birds could give us an idea where the queen is. But while we do that, I mean, look at that mist sitting low ahead of us this morning. A very chilly 11 degrees Celsius when we started, about 51 Fahrenheit. Now at this age, those cubs are probably well adept at avoiding hyenas themselves when mom's not there. I'm pretty sure they've been found in their hiding spots by hyenas. And they are they're quite capable of climbing trees and are already probably faster. That's the reason we moved quite far away from it was we wanted to give her space so she could hear and listen, and that's why we came probably about a kilometer ahead of where she was heading. I don't want to go crashing around in the bush with hyenas around and impair her hearing at all. I'm quite confident that we lost that.
It seems as though we lost Brent, so we do apologize for that. I mean, we didn't lose him completely. He's somewhere there. He just lost his vehicle signal. But you've arrived at the perfect time because a hippopotamus is giving us the hairy eyeball, glancing at us out of the corner of his eye. He's gone completely, totally still, and he's trying to work out whether or not he should run at us or run away from us, or whether it's worth just staying there to munch on a blade or two of grass. And at this time of year, this is why it's so important, first thing in the morning, especially, or on cloudy days, any time of the day, to be so, so careful when you're out on foot. Around dams is the most important place to be on the lookout, but absolutely anywhere, because of course a hippo can travel miles and miles at night. And because they are desperately trying to meet their nutritional needs, on a cold morning like this morning, they take full advantage of the low temperatures to spend a bit more time out and foraging. This is probably the same hippo bull that James saw yesterday at Buffalzug Dam. He can be quite tetchy, which is why I said he's attempting to make up his mind what he's going to do. Unfortunately for us, we've got a few trees between us and him. But I don't really want to stay for too long because I actually don't want to upset him more than anything else. And it's sort of close on at this point, because it's a big bull hippopotamus, I would say he's probably over 2 tons, so over 4,500 pounds in weight, which is significantly heavier than myself and Dave and the vehicle. Hello, boy. Shame. One has to feel really, really sorry for the hippopotamuses at the moment. And there we go. For Chris, who wanted an answer to this question, Chris has said, this reserve has man-made water holes, does it not? And are they being filled? And if so, how often? So Chris, yes. Now that's the interesting thing. It's one of the reasons why there are now hippopotamus in an area where there shouldn't really be huge numbers of hippopotamus. And that is because in the northern Sabi sands, which doesn't have any major river systems, there are all kinds of man-constructed dam structures, waterhole structures, that brought in hippopotamus in numbers that they would not previously have existed in. Now, of course, we get to the stage where, with the drought, they have nowhere to go. Is he sleeping now? No, he's just watching. Relaxed a lot since we first arrived. So, Chris, not all of the waterholes are pumped. There are two on Juma that are pumped regularly. It's usually about once every 2 or so days, depending on the temperatures and how much water has evaporated. So the Juma waterhole, the Juma pan, and the Galago pan are pumped once every 2 days. They're very small, and bear in mind that water has to come from somewhere. It comes from deep beneath the surface of the soil. How beautiful is that light, by the way? But there is limited supply to that, so we've got to hope we'll be able to keep pumping it for the next few months, but we've really got to hope that rains arrive and replenish the supplies of underground water. He's gorgeous. Okay, let's leave him be. He's fine, he's absolutely okay with us, but I think let's just leave him be. I hate stressing out the hippos at the moment. I just feel so sorry for them. Not that I ever like stressing them out, but it feels particularly bad at the moment. I think we'll leave our hippopotamus be. But yes, very important to remember around waterholes such as this one, be very, very cautious of hippos. What they do sometimes as well is they have a long night of walking and they go to sleep. And you think you've found a dead hippopotamus because they sleep so deeply and you can't actually, because of all of the layers, you can't actually see them breathing. And more than one person that I know of has gone forward to have a look at what they thought was a dead hippopotamus, only to find that it's very much a live hippopotamus and very grumpy at being woken from its nap. Okay. If I were a lion, I would be on Buffalzug Dam wall, basking in the rays of the sun, but apparently, I'm not a lion and I can't read their minds. And all is quiet at Buffalzug Dam, as far as I can tell. No hippo, but that's because we know exactly where our hippo is. And shame, very little water cover left for him. Right, onwards to the den site of those lions. While we head there, let's find out how the chaps on foot are doing.
The chaps on foot are doing very well because the cloud has disappeared from in front of the sun, and so the precipitousness of the morning has returned, and our faces are warming in the golden sun as the coolth of the night dissipates. That is very poetic, don't you think, Chandra? Chandra doesn't think that was poetic, but that's because he barely speaks English. Now, here we have what's known as a red thorn tree, and you can see very clearly why it's called a red thorn. Because it's got very red bark, and that bark is made red by tannins, and those tannins, of course, were used extensively by, I think, probably the early Boer settlers in this area to tan leather. Now, the process of tanning leather I know nothing about, other than it makes it this reddish colour, and I think protects the leather slightly from the elements. So that's what they used to use, the inner bark of this tree, Acacia gerardii, the red thorn. Now, it's also rather good tasting. And this tree, you can see, has been mangled many, many times. And it's been mangled by elephants because they're trying to get at this delicious inner bark. And unfortunately, I lost my knife. Well, I haven't lost it. I just couldn't get it this morning for various uncomplicated reasons that should not concern you. But I'm going to try and retrieve something of it for you to taste because I know you all want to taste it. There you are. Jean-André, will you vicariously eat this for the viewers, please? No, you can't. Because you were holding your camera. Shall I do it? Oh, there we go. Well done. And Jean-André will tell you what it tastes like. There we go. I've got a nice piece here. It's quite nice and sweet. Much sweeter than any of the other acacias. And Samsung, why are we sitting here? It's actually an interesting question you've asked. You said, what is the most medicinal plant that we have in this area? Well, I don't know that you can say that the most medicinal, but there's certainly some that are used a little bit more than others. This particular one here that we're looking at, that is growing in the red thorn tree, is something called mbezana. Now, mbezana is the Shangaan name for it. Its English name is the Bushman's grape, and it's growing as a creeper into this tree. I don't know that it's particularly used medicinally, but it certainly uses an important source of forage, and it smells horrendous. Its Afrikaans name, which I'm going to say live, if you can believe it, is perdepus. Now, perdepus basically means horse's urine, and apparently it smells like horse's urine. It does not smell very nice at all, but it makes a nice fruit that tastes like your roast chicken. Your sort of roast chicken lunch mixed in with the apple crumble and cream that you would have had afterwards. So that's what this fruit tastes like. Not very medicinal, but the elephants do like it. I imagine the tree here that is the most kind of used medicinally is probably a marula tree, you know. And there are lots of different ways that the roots are used, the bark is used, the fruit is obviously used. I'm not sure about the leaves, but it's used for a variety of different ailments and things like that. Also, the magic gwari, Euclea divinorum, none of which I can see around me here, they're also very extensively used. And the marula trees, if you can believe it, there isn't one around here. They're common everywhere. Yeah, well, there's one. There's not a very good example of one, but that's a marula tree just up there without its leaves on it, stretching up into the beautiful blue winter's sky. Right, Herbie's just up ahead. He's looking under some logs and things to see if we can find anything to eat. And here is the mbezana again, or the Bushman's grape. Hello, Pinchy Winer's Hat. Very nice question from you. You say, do I prefer the smell of petrichor or the apricity of the morning? Well, I think it depends on the time of the year, really. At this time of the year, I prefer apricity. I don't really want rain when it's so cold. And then during the summer months, I guess I prefer to have the petrichor of the coming storms. Thank you, Pinchy Winer's Hat. If you don't know what's going on with these strange words, everyone, they've been taught to me by our very kind viewers. Petrichor, the smell of the earth, created by the release of various aromatic oils after the first rains of the season, or not even the first rains, any rains of the season, and a prisky is apparently the warmth on the face of the sun. Now, very nice indeed. And just look around here, you can see how the elephants are totally, totally changing the landscape. They're eating away all of these plants, breaking them off, not killing them. They've all adapted to coping with them. This is a silver clusterleaf tree. This is a red bush willow tree. This particular tree is called a variable bush willow tree. And I mean, the differences are not particularly important, but to say that you can see they're all being destroyed by elephants, but none of them are dead. Here's another red thorn tree. Here's a knob thorn tree. And none of them are dead. These ones do die quite a lot, but they also create quite horrible monospecific stands, and so the elephants keep them clear. Okay, Brent is still tracking Karula. Let's go and find out how he's doing with that particular escapade.
We've had no luck yet, so I think she's still in that block south of that little river system we're at. I'm going to take a bit of a chance next. So I'm working on the assumption that she's caught something. That's why she's come back to those cubs. And I'm going to check treehouse down quickly, and if I get nothing in this area, I'm going to go back and I'm going to try backtrack Karula to see if we can backtrack to where there's possibly a kill in a tree somewhere. So just one quick dash past treehouse, and if there's nothing here, we're going to head back. Her tracks were coming from the northeast, so probably around Chelepan. So we're going to head towards that direction, see if we can see where the tracks come from. Now, if she has caught something and she has stashed it and she's gone back to fetch the cubs, she probably would have walked a very direct line from wherever that is back to the cubs. So it's much easier. Let's just listen quickly. It always pays. No alarm calls at the moment. Just gonna be on the radio with Tax for a second. Standing by. Okay, copy. Thanks, Taxi. I'll check treehouse up to Shabam. Copy, thanks. Okay, so that's good news. Taxon's got tracks of Karula and both cubs crossing over on top of my tracks from where we were checking earlier. Sorry? Oh, sorry, we're getting a bit of fog from the very cold morning, so Brian's just going to wipe it quickly. And then Mobile Paddy, I think Karula and the cubs are as mobile as you are, but being Mobile Paddy, Paddy would like to know whether Karula's cubs can keep up with Karula if she's moving at a high speed. She'll adjust her speed for the cubs, but they are deceptively quick already. So they'll be able to jog with her. So Taxon's found her tracks coming into this area to the south of us. So we're going to check very, very slowly, very carefully along here. Okay, so she's an incredibly good mother, and you probably find she knew those hyenas were following her as she was heading back, and that's why she crossed straight through the drainage line. She looked, quite not 100% relaxed, and she was calling a little bit frantically when she couldn't find the second cub. And I think it's possibly because she knew those hyenas were on her tail. Okay, so hopefully we'll spot her soon. There's a water buck in front of us. That's not what we're looking for. Yeah, female waterbuck. Morning, madam. Now, there's an old quarry or burrow pit from when they were building Gowrie Main that Krula sometimes likes to head towards, so we're going to go there. I know, I'm sure quite a few of you are concerned about the hyenas following Krula, but that is what hyenas do. Yeah, that is an age-old game that's been played out for millennia out here in the African bushveld. Hyenas have developed into that incredible opportunist, and they will often follow leopards by scent. Standing by, Tax. Copy. Thanks very much, Taxi. I'll let the guys in the east know. Okay, so she's crossed our southern boundary. Now, whether she's got a kill there, but I don't think so from where her tracks were coming. So we're going to go check back on her tracks and also at the same time head towards where I think the Nkuhuma Pride might have crossed last night. Oh, and we're getting some more misting on the lens in this cold morning. So while we continue on our endeavours this morning, let's go to James, who's got a creepy crawly.
This is the ultimate creepy crawly, everybody, and it is, I love the local name for it, Kogolochi. Which, of course, is just taking it from the English cockroach. It is a kind of cockroach. Cockroaches, of course, come in many guises. And this particular one, Jean-André, if I'm going to try and twist him up towards you, this particular Kogolochi has got armor plating on the back of him. Can you see that at all, Jean-André? He's got armor plates. And I had him on my hand, but he didn't like being there, and so he crawled into this piece of log. And here he believes that he is safe from me. He is, in fact, completely safe from me regardless, because he is a cockroach. And I know many of you will think a cockroach an utterly disgusting creature, but there he is. He's quite a splendid fellow. Look at his amazing detail and his little armor plates. What do you think, Jandro? Would you like to keep him as a pet? What would you call him?
James.
James the cockroach. I see. Jandro, wait till we're next on there. Isn't that lovely? And look at his feelers. Let's see if he cleans them. They're very fastidious cleaners of their feelers, these fellows.
Perhaps he could clean your nails.
He could clean my nails. Perhaps he could clean your hair. But touche, yes. Now, many people would think that imagine the feeling of a cockroach crawling on them to be possibly the most disgusting thing. Thankfully, he didn't go up my shirt. Okay, we're going to put him down. And I think you'll find the reason he's now so mobile is that he's warmed up as a result of being on my skin. And of course, it is still pretty cold, and insects are very incapable of moving. incapable of moving during the cold of the morning. Now, Jamie has managed to find some tiny of my little thing to call you.
And you know, I think that James, out of all of us, might be the biggest softies, but it is absolutely impossible to not fall instantly in love with this little bundle of fur that is in front of you. Mom is here, and I'm speaking very softly because it's bedtime for tiny, weeny little cubbies. Oh, big stretch. It's amazing how fast they grow. I mean, we've been watching them each and every day, and already the ears just starting to pop up. I know it's I know it's really difficult to see, but that is in fact the sleeping face of a tiny little lion cub wrapped up in Mom's fur. It's absolutely incredible where she's hidden herself. If you did not know she was here, which of course we do know that she is here, but if you did not know that she was here, you would never ever have found her. Unless, of course, you went for a walk and accidentally strayed a bit too close, at which point you would find yourself on the receiving end of some Harley Davidson-style growling. But it is a very, very tricky area. I'm speaking nice and softly, and this is pretty much the best view that we can get for now. And as you know, we're not going to stay forever. Well, not forever, but we're not going to stay for very long. We don't want to have a major impact on these little cubs' lives. They're still incredibly tiny. Oh, little one. Oh, that is cute. And his siblings wriggling around at the back. Utterly irresistible. And let's see, this is the extraordinary thing. This is where the magic of Safari Live really lies. Not with babies, not that babies aren't wonderful, but with the prospect and possibility of following an animal's life from this point, young and pure innocence personified, to adulthood. And we all eagerly await their proper arrival, getting to know them, getting to observe their characters. That is what makes Safari Live so special, that sort of constant experience of nature out here. Oh, are you very cozy there? They look so warm, I almost want to go and join them. I definitely don't. Hello, little one. Number two at the back. As they nestle into Mom. Oh. Oh, look at that foot. And these sharp little claws. Oh, it's too sweet. Okay, we've all gone soppy now. Sorry, Vic. You wanted to know whether or not this is the youngest set of Nkuhuma cubs. And we think so. But we do believe that there is another set of Nkuhuma cubs as well. So we think that there are three. That is because when I was with one mother with her three cubs, Brent had two lactating females. So this den site we know of, we don't know where the other den site is, but we strongly suspect that there is another set of cubs. But what we don't know is whether or not they are younger than this lot or older. Just bear with me one moment, guys. I just want to hop onto the Game Drive channel. Stations, I've been through to check. The one Mufuzzy is here with the young Mupimpans. No problem. Just letting everybody know that she is here. There's another vehicle off to away from us. Just want to make sure that they don't accidentally come and see what I'm looking at and then join us in the sighting, because we do want to... Oh, hello. We do want to keep it as just one vehicle. Oh, ho, ho. Hi, baby. Oh, you both adorable. Such sleepy faces. Oh, they are so tiny. Oh, just stand on sibling to get where you want to go. Feet everywhere. Oh, struggling out underneath the weight of another cub. I think that might... Yes, that is. There's the third one. The head of the third one at the back. It's just a pile of cubs. Feet everywhere. Fur everywhere. Oh, my goodness. It's too gorgeous. They're like little wriggly worms. And just to give you an idea in the terms of a sense of scale, because I think it's very difficult for you to picture or to grasp through the eyes of the camera exactly how small these creatures are. They're probably about... They're probably less than the length of my forearm. So from the base of my palm to my elbow, they're smaller than that. They're about half that size. They are absolutely minute. Too cute. I can't see them at all. I have to see them through Dave's eyes. Looking for breakfast at this point, trying to get hold of Mum and have a jolly good suckle. And of course, life's pretty easy for these chaps at this point. Their Mum is a ready-made milk bar for the first 3 months of their lives, but after that, of course, they have to shift their diet to their predatory diet that they will have for the rest of their lives. And for example, Karula's cubs that she is now are now fully weaned and on their way, hopefully, back to a kill. But Zach would like to know how long a predator can go without food, and if they don't make a kill, what are their alternative food sources? So they don't really necessarily, Zach, have alternative food sources, just to clarify. That was me, by the way, taking my foot off the brake, not Dave. It was not Dave's camera work at all. So Zach, they can actually go for up to 3 weeks, maybe even 4 weeks, but by that point they're going to be incredibly bad condition. They're going to be very, very weak and very thin, but that is how long they can go without making a kill, as long as they've got access to water. The dehydration is what's going to get them, like human beings, before a lack of nutrients does. Usually, however, they start to look really hungry at about 7 days. 7-8 days is when they start to seem... They're very determinedly hunting. They're obligate carnivores, but they will scavenge things. They might snack on things like birds' eggs if they can catch them, lizards. They generally don't bother, but if they're really desperately hungry, then they might. And especially for little cubs, they will practice their killing skills on those sorts of things, their hunting skills. Let's see what these little bundles of fluff are up to. As I said, I can't see them at all. Where'd they go? Down a bit. There we go. These are the little ones. They've completely made life very difficult for us. Disappearing behind the leaves there. Michael, how we look at our little spotted cubs, or in theory we look at our little spotted cubs, they are... Unbelievably, they're just little bits of movement behind the trees. You can see Dave trying to show you where they are, but it's very, very tricky. Michael, our cubs are currently very spotted. You wanted to know why it is that some lionesses lose their spots completely whilst others don't have more spots. Age plays a big factor. So obviously, when they're cubs, they've got the little spots to help to camouflage them. Oh, little one. I'm so glad they've got their mom here. And keep them nice and warm on a cold morning. So age is a big factor. So the youngest Nkuhuma lioness has more vivid spot colourings than the rest of the pride. It does start to, they do start to fade with age. But as with anything, tail on, head, oh, look at those spotted faces. Oh, do you get more precious than that? I don't think so. I have to try and stop cooing at them. So uncoordinated at this stage. And now, tail on sibling's head. That's a lion cub head there, wrapped in a tail. So there we've got the spots that Michael was talking about. Also bear in mind that just like human beings with brown hair or blonde hair or black hair or whatever combination one has to have, happens to have, or in Kirsty's, oh, was that a big yawn? Kirsty's case, bright red. So genetics does play a role in the physical appearance of the little cubs. Oh. While our little cubs decide whether or not they're going to come out a bit more into the open and make our lives a bit easier, let's go over to James, who has found a lava thing.
This was described by Louise in the final control, everybody, as interesting but ew. And it is a bit interesting but ew. You can see it's moving there. And it is a pupa. Now, a pupa, for those of you who don't know, is part of what we call a hollow metabolic life cycle. So something like a butterfly is the most obvious one. Where the caterpillar pupates like this, goes into this chrysalis, and then emerges as a beautiful butterfly. Now, this particular one, Herbert reckons, is a wasp. I'm not sure what it is, but you can see it is moving around inside there, and is probably shortly to hatch. So this, in Shangan, is called Venga. That's what a wasp is. I think that's quite a nice name, Venga. Probably slightly too honourable sounds, I think, for a hornet or a wasp. So that's this. And I pulled it out of the bark in a flaky thorn tree. So I'm going to have to find another spot for it to go, because it would be sad if it didn't make it all the way to fruition with its twiddling end there. Quite nice. So that's what that is. And then if you come over here, Herbert also found, I'm going to put the Venga in this little tree hole here. Good luck, Venga. Don't sting anyone when you are big. Just be nice. Don't be kak, be lekker. Right. Come and look over here, everyone. Here is a very strange thing to see in the summertime. Oh, sorry. Let's go back to the lion cubs. They're being very cute.
Very cute indeed. I can't quite be as girly as James manages when he sees lion cubs. Oh, come back, little one. We just got the most perfect view of its little face. But it's decided to bury itself into Mom's side. Ah, but they really are utterly irresistible. Dave, have you ever seen anything cuter than this?
Definitely not.
This is the youngest I have ever seen lion cubs. In my entire life, I've seen lions carrying cubs of around this age, but it was a lioness moving den sites, and I didn't stay with her for very long. Now, this is probably the youngest that I have ever seen lion cubs, and it's just extraordinary. Oh, little one, you made life difficult. But we're not going to stay for too much longer. We are going to pull out in the next 4 or so minutes. Hello. Come on. Come this way. Dave, do you think if we go forward we're going to lose a view? Okay. Shall we risk it? Let's risk rolling forward. Okay. I'm going to watch my monitor. Okay. Okay. Yes, sir. Oh, no. Sorry, guys. I've got a little bit of a face. Oh. Hello, little one. You are utterly gorgeous. Okay. So, guys, in terms of our viewing policies and why we are watching these little ones with mom, it's something that we do very, very carefully. We're viewing them with the mother here, but for very limited period of time. Why then do we not look at leopard cubs at all before they're about 2 months old, and yet we are willing to watch these cubs with mom at this age? And they're probably, is some debate between the various people, but a couple, probably about 2 or so weeks. And the answer to that is just in terms of the vulnerability of a female leopard versus a female lion. So the reason we don't view leopard cubs when they're very, very young is because they actually have more in the way that is a threat out there than the lions do. The biggest threat while a mother is with her cubs, to her cubs, the only thing that is a threat to her is a male lion. Hyenas, she'd be able, I mean, unless it was a huge hyena clan, hyenas she would be able to defend the cubs from. And hyenas are very, very unlikely to attempt to attack a lioness with the little ones. And the rest of the lions in this area are all part of her family. They're all part of her pride. So the biggest threat to her is a male lion. We know that things are relatively stable with other lions of this area. And either way, there would be nothing. We would not have any impact if a male lion did decide to come in here. A leopard situation is different because they are much more vulnerable than lionesses, and they also don't have the additional assistance of the rest of the pride in terms of hunting and in terms of looking after their little ones. That's a different approach that we do. We're also, as I said, limited to our time here, so we only put one vehicle in for a little bit of the time in the morning. It's also valuable for us to be able to know where she is and if she is here, because as I said, you don't really want to go stumbling into her. But then we leave straight away and nobody else comes in until they're a little bit older. You can see that we are not making any major noise, we're not making any sounds, except when we come in and then we leave again. We don't reposition much, might roll forward a little bit. But we're incredibly, incredibly sensitive to the animals that we care about. And don't forget that we do live our lives caring about these animals as much as anybody does. And we would never do anything to jeopardize them. We really wouldn't. And talking about the social structure of lionesses, Michael, yes. Lionesses do have that option. They do allosuckle, so they do take care of each other's cubs and they do suckle each other's cubs. That is one of the big reasons why they've got this incredible pride system, a support base for all the mothers. And that's why they try and time their babies around the same time. And they've got all three of the five Nkunguma lionesses have now got cubs, which means three potential mothers should anything happen. And they will raise another lioness's cubs. And Michael, in terms of number of nipples, they've got four main ones that they utilize. And like with big cats or with kittens, just, I don't know if you saw there, we might have just had a glimpse of mom's face. And just like kittens, the lion cubs generally have an established nipple. So their nipple, essentially, that they go back to when they suckle. Sometimes there's a little bit of conflict though, as you can imagine. And they need the mother's side just in the same way that domestic cats and puppies do. It is time for us to go. This will be our last few moments spent with them, and then we're going to leave this lioness to peacefully feed her family. appears to be a beehive somewhere here as well. I've been sitting listening and I've just got this constant buzzing. Unless I'm imagining it. Dave, have you heard it? It does sound like buzzing. Don't see any aircraft. Right, guys, we are going to have to go relatively soon. You can get an idea of just how comfortable the cubs are and how much we do care about them and to look after them. So we're going to leave them, and we're going to leave them to their morning. Keep them safe, Mom. Look after them carefully. Meantime, James has found something with a bit more legs than a lion cub.
That's because Andrew's an idiot.
Andre, sorry. Everyone, we did find a spider, but there are two birds flying around. Oh, they've gone. They look like two chagras, and they flew right close up by, but Andre couldn't swing around because he'd have frightened them away. Very unusually, for this time of year, we found a perfectly intact golden orb or garden orb web spider. Herbie's just pointing out these birds. Sorry, everyone. They're flying around us. Can you see them, Dondry? Ah, they've gone away now. Right, so garden orb web spider, different from the golden orb web spider. And you know the orb web spiders, which create these orb webs, obviously, which are horizontal to the plane of the ground, if you like. They only come from one family of spiders. And although they're the most recognizable spiders, only one family of, probably more than 100 different spider families creates these very recognizable orb webs. And this particular one is completely intact, very unusual for the winter time, and he's just caught a fly. John, he actually caught that fly off your leg, believe it or not. You've just fed the spider. Can you see the fly? Here it is over here. It's come off Gendre's vast calf. It was so amazed by what it saw that it was disorientated and flew into the web. Now, the garden orb web spider here, in fact, Gendre's provided him with two. Her with two. She's probably not moving. There. She's going to get it. Look. She's grabbed it. She's missed it. Nope. Got it now. There she is. She's bitten it. She's sticking her fangs into it now. Fangs biting into the abdomen. She'll take it down to the middle of the web, and while that venom digests the fly inside its exoskeleton, and as Steph likes to say, it turns it into a milkshake, she'll then suck it out. But while she waits for that to happen, she'll wrap it in silk. Now let's see, it's not a very big piece of prey, and it'd be quite interesting to see if she does actually wrap it. The back of her, or where her spinnerets are, I think she's going to eat it straight like that. I don't think she's going to bother and wrap it up at all. Isn't that amazing? How cool is that, Jandri? Very, yes. You've just fed this garden orb-web spider breakfast. And the garden orb-web spider this time of year will struggle to move, as I've said. Very cold. And that's...
There's many more on my...
Should we try and feed her some more, Gendre? I'm just going to fetch some off Gendre's leg. Blow them in. No, there's one went in. It's escaped now. And as Louise says, we shouldn't feed wild animals. Thank you, Louise. Yes, that is absolutely correct. Anyway, that is the garden orb web spider. Very happy Mrs. Garden Orb Web Spider. Oh, she's just got another one. Oh, look, she's going to get them. Watch this. Aaron in New Zealand. Look, she's going up to fetch them. Look at that. Oh, that's wonderful. Gee whiz. So, Aaron, you want to know if we get widow spiders here, the button spiders? We do. We get brown and black button spiders, or widows. Not very commonly, but they are here. And they can do a bit of damage to you. They won't kill you, but they can do a bit of damage. Now, that's interesting. She's got both those flies in her jaws there now. She hasn't noticed the other one. Oh, what a fate, Chandra, eh? Look what you've done to these flies. They've had a very bad morning, thanks to you. They've found an enormous source of food on your substantial calves, and now they're being devoured. Oh, she's just picking up on the movement of the others now. So how she knows is that when they sit still, she doesn't know that they're there. But as soon as they start to move and struggle, where they're stuck on the web, she picks up... There, she's wrapping them up. You see that? Chandra, are you getting this? Mm-hmm. Oh, that's fantastic. What a brilliant shot. So she's using her back legs there and the spinnerets at the back, and she's wrapping them up now. I'm going to sneeze. Excuse me, everybody. Thank you, Chandra. There, she's left them wrapped up at the bottom, and she's going to fetch the next one. No problem. She's bitten the other one. Now she's wrapping it up too. She's taking it straight down. Let's see if she wraps this one up. She's wrapped up the other two very tightly. This is incredible. Especially for winter. I mean, this really is very special indeed. So not venomous to human beings, but that venom, which is the beginning of the digestive process for the spider, definitely very venomous to these little flies. And she might be able to give you a slight nip, I suppose, but it certainly wouldn't harm you greatly. She's just wrapping them all up again. She's going to put them in the same package. I think she is. Putting them in the same package. Ah, this is just incredible. Holding them now with those pedipalps at the front. And there she'll sit until she... Well, she's just picked up on the other one moving. See if she grabs this one. There's one off towards the sun, to the eastern side of her web now. Let's see if she takes that one too. Oh, she's looking at it. She's actually eating the other one. She's eating the third one she caught. Oh, and this one on the eastern side of the web is getting itself into awful trouble. It's starting to struggle. And its days, its minutes are numbered. Here she comes. She's moving in for the kill. Oh, dear. What a fate, knowing that you're about to be ended by the spiky fangs of a spider. Ooh. Marilee in Illinois, you want to know how often a spider must eat in the winter to stay alive. Marilee, I couldn't tell you. Safe to say that I imagine she can probably survive many days without eating anything, because if they're inactive... Remember that they're almost dormant, so they don't use any energy. Much like a reptile or an amphibian, which can kind of shut down the metabolism. They're not warm-blooded, which means that they don't have to produce their own body heat, which means that they don't have a very high energy load. And so she can go days without eating anything, especially in the wintertime when it's cold. Chandra, you have made the spiders weak. Well done. You do a very good job. I wish you could see what I'm seeing here. Herbert has returned here and he's found a whole lot of flies on Chandra and he's waving his hands towards the web to feed it further flies. Let's caught another one. Isn't that amazing? I can't believe it. The spider's been sat here for weeks waiting for something to fly in here, and suddenly to its small spider brain, it can't figure out why, but there are hundreds and hundreds of flies landing in its web. Because of Gendre. Thank you, Gendre. You may hear Herbert having a giggle there, but he's throwing them into the web here. I know, that's not very nice. Okay, everybody, I think we should move away from... You like them? Okay. Gendre says he's not going anywhere. He's going to enjoy the spider. All right. I think that's enough death and destruction for one day, everyone. Let's go across to Brent Learsmith and find out what his plans are from here.
We found the lion tracks where they've crossed from Buffalo's Hook into Juma. And they crossed just to the west of us here. Now I'm going to check on this road, see if they utilize the fire break. I don't see any cub tracks for the other set of cubs, but I could only see tracks of three lioness. And there's of course the tracks of the fourth lioness going straight down towards where Jamie is. Just going to go very slowly, very carefully. There's some hard patches here. Let's check now if they crossed here or if they kept going on that big animal path. You're looking carefully, Brian. And no tracks here. So I'm going to keep going. If we don't get them coming out on this road here, I'll go back to last tracks. They could still be in the block. Maybe they had a successful hunt last night. Slowly, checking very, very carefully in this absolutely splendid winter's morning. And then Brian's showing you a termite mound with a jackalberry on top of it. Nothing hiding in the shade of the jackalberry. Hi, Sammy! Sammy's a brand new viewer. He's just found Safari Live. Well, Sammy, welcome to the family. Sammy's wondering, how long do we stay out? Well, Sammy, we stay out at the moment from 6 a.m. Central African time to... 6:30 a.m. Central African time to 9:30 a.m. Central African time. And then in a few short hours, we start the sunset safari. So we're busy on our sunrise safari at the moment. So the sunset safari starts at 3 p.m. Central African time and continues till 6 p.m. Central African time. So we are out at different times of the day for 6 hours, 3 hours in the early morning and 3 hours in the evening. And Sammy, we're tracking lions at the moment, so welcome to our vehicle. Now we had the tracks going in there, and I just want to check very carefully on this road, make sure we don't miss them popping out. If not, I'm going to go back to where those tracks are and maybe have a little walk, see if I can find them on foot. And so while we continue to check, let's go back to James and his ravenous spider.
Continued to eat and wrap up various flies while you've been away, and she's left them at the top of the web, and Gendre is getting some unbelievable close-up shots of her spinnerets spitting out silk, and then she'd use those back legs of hers and the middle legs, or the what would you call them, the secondary back legs, if you like, difficult to say, the two that aren't quite at the back but are nearly at the back, and she was using all of those as the silk came out of her spinnerets at the bottom there. She was using those to wrap up the flies. And she's got a package of 5 or 6 of them in the middle of the web where we originally found her. And she's now catching yet another one that has flown off Gendre onto this bush. Sorry, Gendre, I've moved the bush for you. That's hopeless. Sorry about that. Isn't that amazing? And Justin, you're wondering about the strength of the web. Justin, this particular web, not as strong as some of the others. So the golden orb web spider out here, the Nephila species, they have got webs that are one of the strongest known substances known to us at all, you know, anywhere in the world. They're stronger than high tensile steel, and they're stronger than Kevlar. These ones not so strong, but still for their width and for their thickness, very, very strong, and probably also slightly stronger than steel. So very strong, but they're so thin that you could put your hands through them if you wanted to. And in order to prevent much larger animals doing that, what they've got there are those white things called the stabilimentum. And those stabilimentum, we think, prevent big birds and other larger predators, or maybe even dung beetles and that sort of thing, flying into the web and destroying it. So bits of prey that she wouldn't be able to cope with can see those stabilimenta. I think they also reflect ultraviolet light, and so they might attract the smaller insects into them. There she goes back again, towards the middle. I think she's exhausted from all of this breakfast. It's like I feel after a bowl of oatmeal. Ah, that's fantastic. We did hear, while you're watching that spider, we did hear some zebra alarm calling off to the right hand side of your screen, saying wah, 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 wah. Don't know what that was. We might go and take a look see. Right, Gendre, have you had enough of the spider yet? He's looking very distressed that we're thinking about leaving the spider. He's had a wonderful time here, but I think we probably will press on slightly. Is that all right, Gendre? Thank you. Well done. Good job. We'll follow Herbie out here. I think we will go and have a look, just quickly see where the if the zebras have spotted anything that's worth having a look at. Wonderful that you saw those tiny little lion cubs. I'm very jealous of that, but I'm glad Jamie got to see them. And I'm sorry about the fact that that Karula has gone south of our boundary. Nasty lady. All right, let's go back across to Jamie and get an update from her. We're getting a bit of breakup. We'll go into a better signal area.
Oh, well, James finds a better signal area. Oh, I found you some Inyala. Hello, guys. Oh, this is the perfect place to stop. It's marvelous. Time to bask in the morning sunlight and gather up a bit of body warmth before Dave and myself race east across to Cheetah Plains to see what is around there. But for now, we've got some lovely Lady Nyala with her deep, rich red-brown ochre colour. And one little fuzzy male, just starting to get the fluffiness that will slowly, when he's a bit older, turn into an impressive dark colouring and a very saggy beard. But for now, he just looks a little bit gangly. Hasn't even really started growing his horns just yet. Just the tips poking out at the top of his head. Kind of looks like one of those teenagers that has started to grow a beard, is trying to grow a beard. Clopping their way through the bushes. And Shamsun, just talking about our health of our animals in general, the Inyala, relatively resilient creatures. They will be ones that survive this drought quite well. But Shamsun would like to know, as the drought draws on, will we be seeing more dead animals? And Very sadly, the answer is yes, absolutely we will. We'll lose some... Oh, nice. Thank you, Dave. Sheltering me from the sun there, the brightness of the sun. yes, we will. The first to go will be things like buffalo and warthog. We might even lose some of the bulk grazers, maybe like the zebra as well. We're going to lose one or two. Now go back there, Dave. It's too bright.
I thought you wanted the heat.
All right. Sorry, I'm not giggling at that. I'm just getting a little bit of shade from Dave. Marvelous news, though, is that Brent, true to form, has been incredibly successful this morning, and he has managed to find you some other lines.
So we're checking around, we didn't find any tracks as we're coming down the road, and I was expecting to find tracks in this area. I suddenly saw him. He's just hiding behind a bush there. There you go, one of the Birmingham boys. And then just to our right, three of the Nkuma ladies. No sign of the other sets of cubs. So you'll probably find those two females are with their cubs, wherever they might be. Like they're enjoying a nice bask in the early morning sunshine. And it doesn't look like they were successful in hunting last night. See, she's grooming herself. Difficult to see which lioness is. The only one I know for sure, when she's flopped her head down now, is that one there. That's Amber Eyes. We're in a bit of a thicket here, so what I'm going to try do is move around so we can get a nice visual of the male as well as the three lionesses. I'm just trying to think which is going to be the best way to do that. Of course, the lionesses are lying in the best way to do that, so I'm going to have to go a little bit wider. Sorry, madam. Okay, let's try to find a good spot to view the big boy as his head's up. Oh! Ducking and diving. Watch your head, Brian. And the lions at the moment are on Gallagher Shortcut Road. Probably about 100 meters from the Buffalo's Hook cut line, and 100 meters to the south of the Buffalo's Hook cut line, and about 40 meters to the west of the road. That's for James, who's on foot. He's just wanting to make sure where the lions were so he doesn't walk into us. We're going to get ourselves into prime position shortly. And the cat luck continues. Now, every single drive since I've been back from leave, I've been lucky enough to have cat sightings, and quite often multiple cat sightings. Look at that. How's that, Brian? We'll move around where we can see the lionesses as well, but let's have a look at that Birmingham boy, those golden eyes staring at us. Oh, they were staring, he's now closed them. Now, Brian thinks this might be the same male you saw on Cheetah Plains yesterday. with James. I'm not sure, but if you guys know, let us know, because that means he's walked an incredibly long distance. So let us know, is this the same male you saw in Cheetah Plains yesterday? If you know, hashtag Safari Live, or use the email questions@wildearth.tv. Now, speaking about how far lions move, Zach was wondering. Zach, it all depends. The males generally move bigger distances than the females. They've got a massive area of around 20,000 acres that they've got to patrol and protect from other males. So there's four males in this coalition. And on average, they probably do 7 to 10 kilometers in a night if they're on the march. But they can do as much as 25 kilometers in a night. Yeah, let's move around a bit more so we can see the ladies as well. Watch the thorns behind you there, Brian. Slowly. There we go. So now we should have, we've got that beautiful male, and then we've got the lionesses just in front of us. Gorgeous. Oh, bless you, there's a lioness sneezing in front of us. And it's the lady who was up and grooming. There we go. Just move my fat head out of the way. Actually, when you see she's breathing, you can see it's still chilly, and you can actually see the condensation coming out of her mouth. There we can see, reasonably hungry. Oopsie, there it goes. Well, it looks like we might get a little bit of late morning movement. Oh, no. Oh, no, just looking for shade. Tired of lying in the sun. And it looks like we've got a lot of heavy heads around us at the moment. And there we go, the other two lionesses are sleeping. The male's half sleeping. Sleepy, sleepy. Oh, there we go. Look at those eyes. Absolutely gorgeous. Eyes are closed. But speaking of lions, Jamie's got some of their footprints to show you.
Have got such a beautiful shot of some of their footprints, and to say some of their footprints is actually putting it mildly, because at some point during the night the Styx, I assume it's the Styx, I don't know for certain, but it's most likely the Styx pride, walked along down this road, taking their little ones with them. And I'm actually going to jump off so I can show you the size difference between the adult tracks and the little cub tracks. It's just such a perfect little example. So many little feet walking around here. Let's not stand on them. Let's grab a stick. Now there's, can you see this track here, Dave?
Yep.
Cool. This is the females, this is the adult females track over here. And I'm outlining it just to make things a bit easier. There we go. So that's the sort of the rough size of the adult. And then if we go a little bit over here, tiny, tiny, perfect little lion cub tracks. And there's so many of them. I mean, it's difficult to show you each and every individual. But to give you a sense of scale, again, here's my hand. This is the track here. This is the back of the track with the little toes. So basically, the size or the length of my forefinger. Tiny, tiny, perfect, crisp, beautiful little cub tracks, and three of them from what I can see. I can count three at least. We know that the Styx cubs, there's eight of them around and about, but they don't necessarily all move together all of the time. So a really marvelous, beautiful example of the proportions between little cub tracks and adult tracks. And that's one of the easiest way to identify between the tracks. If you saw a track that size on its own, it would be a leopard. It would actually be a female leopard, an almost fully grown female leopard. But if you see lots of them wandering about, then you know instantly it is very tiny little lion cub tracks. Oh dear, we appear to be causing a traffic jam. Let us move out of the way. And while we do and head across to Cheetah Plains, let us find out how things are going out on foot.
Things for us are going very well on foot, but things for another creature out here have gone inescapably poorly over the last little while. Now, here, everybody, is a tortoise, a leopard tortoise on his back. Let me pick him up for you. And he's in some trouble. We don't really know what's happened. I'm going to show you where he came from shortly. Herbert found his house after he found him lying on his back like this. Now, what I'm going to do is turn him over, and you can see there in the sun, you can see an injury. Very clearly been injured by something there. This leg seems to be broken. He's unable to pull it back into the shell. The other legs have all been pulled into the shell, as has the tail and has the head. And I mean, maybe you can you see the head there, Gendry? I'll try and get some light onto it. You might just be able to see his nose sticking through there. He is not in a good way. Now, I'll tell you what we think happened to him. We think quite possibly he was chased or kicked out of his home by a herd of impala that came running through here. There are tracks of running impala all over here. And Gendry, if you just want to have a look here to where he came from, if we look down here, he was clearly estivating underneath in this little burrow here. Not a burrow, but it's just a really nice sort of comfortable spot for a tortoise to sit next to a stump of a tree in order to avoid precisely what's actually happened to him. I don't know if he came out for a bite to eat or something like that, but they'll get next to trees like this precisely so that buffalo or kudu or impala don't run past and kick them over. Anyway, this chap got kicked over, and I also want to show you he had a very, very tough life. I think he's going to die now, but I'm not sure, so we're not going to put him out of his misery. Look at this crack down his carapace. This is an old crack from when he was a very young tortoise. You can see it's healed, but it's grown very strangely. And that would have been for many, many years. I'd put this tortoise at well over 30 years old. And for many years, his crack that he developed, obviously as a very young tortoise, just kind of grew strangely. And it just goes to show that these animals are amazingly resilient. So I'm not going to try and put him out of his misery. I think he's in a severe amount of pain. I don't think he's having a good time at all. The only thing I am going to do to help him is put him back in that burrow, and maybe he will survive. I think quite possibly he will die. The last thing to tell you is that these two front scutes here and the two rear scutes are used extensively by traditional fortune tellers or soothsayers to show you the direction that your future will take. On that note, let's head across to Brent Leo Smith, whose present is currently filled with salon quality hair.
James is correct indeed. This particular male does seem to have salon quality hair. I think he goes to the same barber as Brian Joubert, who is the only other person in our camp who can have salon quality hair. I think the person in our camp with the least salon quality hair would be Jandre. And as you can see, it's getting quite warm. Oh, what did he hear? He heard something off to the south of him. You see anything back there, Brian? No, it doesn't look like it. Oh, there could be buffalo in the block, there could be impala, there could be lots of different things. Oh, look at that. Isn't that gorgeous? See how he's lifting his nose, testing the air, seeing what he can smell. He's not opening his eyes while he's doing it. But definitely worth a little snap. I hope you guys are getting some great screenshots of this. And remember to share your screenshots with us. Hashtag Safari Live on Twitter, or pop them on our Facebook page, which is Safari Live. Of course, there's numerous Facebook groups that our fans run. Juma Junkies, Wild Earth Fans. Can you think of the others, Brian? There's lots. And you sure everyone appreciates if you put the screenshots onto any of those groups as well. Oh, there's whatever we're smelling or hearing. Is losing interest, and the head's getting heavier. Is it going to touch the leg? There we go. Oh yes, comfort. The paw pillow, a well utilized thing by lions, both male and female. And thanks very much, Aletta. Aletta says this is not the same male that was seen on Cheetah Plains yesterday. And this male's got more scars on his schnoz. In saying that, though, it is not impossible for a male lion to walk from Cheetah Plains to here. It is quite far, but they are more than capable of doing it. Oh, Brian, I don't know if you're going to be able to catch them, but there's just been an emergence of tiny little insects that have just hatched. I don't know if we're going to be able to catch them. They're literally minute. Maybe if off the front of the bonnet, but they're literally engulfing us. Oh, there's one on the dashboard. Let's try and see what they are. See them there? I think they're baby flies. There. Oh, off it went. Yes, there are. Oh, there's lots of them. Now, it looks like there's just been a hatching of these tiny little flies, and they're sort of copperish. They might be almost little fruit flies. Or fruit fly family. There's so many different fly species, it's near impossible to tell them all. But literally, while we've been sitting here, there's just suddenly been an explosion of these tiny little flies, and they're all around us. But let's look at the lions. They're more interesting than a bunch of fruit flies. And you can actually see them around in the screen, flying around the lions. And they could have hatched out of a pile of dung. You can see lions always have a few scrapes upon them, and it's a tough job catching buffaloes and such. But they are incredibly adept at doing that, and they are hungry. Oh, there we go, head up next door. And going down. Woof. I don't think they're going to stay out in the open sun for too long. Now, lions are covered in a very tightly packed, thin fur on their back. It's a bit fluffier on their bellies. Now, Justin's wondering, even with their fur, could lions be burnt or get a sunburn? It's very unlikely, Justin. What What normally happens, and the reason lions move into the shade, is because their core body temperature raises. So a lion, if a lion's body temperature raises by even 3 or 4 degrees, it can be near fatal. So they try to minimize their movements when it's hot, and I'm quite sure it won't be too long before these two lionesses lying out in the sun here move to join the other lioness who's in the shade. So there she is. And they'll move throughout the day as the sun moves through the sky. Oh, doesn't she look a bit more comfortable in the shade? I think Brian and I, on the other hand, are quite enjoying basking in the sun from that chilly start this morning. And that's probably what the lions were doing before we got here, and that's why they're lying out in the open, enjoying a bit of morning sunshine. Now, I know what Brian's trying to do. We're trying to see if we can see any suckle marks. Not on that female. While we're going to stick around with these lions a bit longer to see what's happening, James is going to teach you some interesting traditional uses of some plants we get out here in the African bush.
We've just had a lesson from Herbert, everybody. It won't be a long lesson for you because you want to go back to the lions, but Herbert has created something here called Ntsonga. And Ntsonga is this little array of sticks here. We've moved the tortoise from his home and we're going to put him back now. But this stick, look at this group of sticks here. It's a model. It's a model of a door that used to be made for a sort of temporary shelter out here if you were living in the bush. He's used, he's used any kind of twig that he could find, but he's used red thorn bark there, just like the red thorn I ate earlier this morning. He's found that bark and tied these sticks together. Now, what people used to do when they lived out in these areas, especially if they were perhaps on a hunting expedition or something like that, they'd find a shelter, maybe a thicket, or they'd make a temporary sort of shelter like this, and then they'd make a door that this, like this, and apparently it would go over the entrance of wherever they were making their temporary refuge, and the lions, if they came up to investigate, would just lie outside. They wouldn't be able to get inside, and they wouldn't try and sort of break through this. What is quite a flimsy wall, but to a lion is something quite substantial. So that's called Ntsonga, and I think we're going to put the tortoise back inside here, and I'm going to put Ntsonga there to protect him from lions and whatever else he might have that might want to come and get him while he convalesces. Okay, Jean-André? All righty, everybody. We'll send you back to the lions and see what they're doing for the rest of the morning.
Well, the lions are doing exactly what they were doing when you last left us. I'm just going to... Sorry, I'm just losing a layer while I was basking in the sun. It was time to take off a jacket. Now, lions lying very close to this each other is quite important. And they are the only social cat. And the bonds between the pride are sometimes tenuous, especially when they've been fighting around a kill. And these quiet times in between meals is where they reaffirm those pride bonds. Now, there's been lots of studies with a lot of different social animals. And the more often they lie close to each other, the stronger the pride is. And we've seen with the Inkahumas, they often lie on top of each other. So it's a very strong pride. The bonds between the adult females are good. And of course, with the new litters coming through, the Inkahumas, if the females out of those little cubs make it to adulthood, the Nkumas are going to be looking like a very strong pride again. Let's just reposition slightly so we can have a look at that female who's lying in the shade. Remember, always let your car run for a few seconds. Even with animals like this that are so relaxed around the vehicles, just let the car run. And if you start and move, you can quite often give the animals a fight. But as you can see, we start, let it run, they haven't moved a muscle, and now we can move. What do you think we should try for the male? See if we can get a view through the bush of his beautiful visage. Bigger stump than I thought it was. There we go. It's so funny with lions and their heads. As they close their eyes, their heads seem to become heavier and heavier. And look, you can see it's just dropping ever so slightly. Oh yes. There you go, back to the paw pillar. So male and female lions will scent mark their territory using urine and scent glands on their paws. And Misty in Tennessee is wondering whether there's a high ammonia smell like you would get with a domestic cat. Not really, Misty. Lion urine, you can smell it, but I wouldn't call it say it's a high ammonia smell. The other thing you can say, well, the other big cat we see frequently, leopard, they've got the most interesting scent mark smell, and it actually smells like buttered popcorn. Lions, you can't really smell too much. Brian, how would you describe a lion urine? It smells like urine, but not a high ammonia smell. And it seems like the little flies have decided Brian is the nicest smelling thing out here in the bush, because they are literally covering his jacket. I can't see if there's any on my back. No, they're just after you. No. Maybe it's your shampoo, Brian.
The luscious locks.
The luscious locks. Hi, Ellen. Ellen is in Arkansas, and Ellen is wondering, do lioness change their hunting behavior when they have cubs? Yes and no, Ellen. So if the rest of the pride are quite close to the den, she will hunt with the pride and then return. And sometimes she can go very far with the pride, like we saw with going to Arethusa on that buffalo kill. But generally, if the pride is out of the area of the den, she will hunt closer to the den. So it all depends on whether the pride's around or not, but sometimes they can move very far from the den. Now, those lionesses last night when they were in Buffalo's Hook, as the crow flies, probably about 3.5 kilometers or so from the den that you were at earlier this morning with Jamie. So they can move great distance from their den sites. Sleepy kitties, let's go have a look at the shaded lioness. She's got her head behind a bush there and looking quite comfortable in the shade. As I said, I think the other two will join her. Shouldn't be too long. Now they are quite hungry, so I think it's definitely going to be quite an exciting sunset safari, unless something bundles into them during the day. I think they're definitely going to be on the hunt this evening, so I'm sure James or Jamie will be here right with them. Very sleepy. And you can see, even though they're lying in the direct sun and it's hot, there's not that heavy breathing that would be associated with a full belly. You can see nice, even, shallow, or not too, sorry, even and deep breaths, not shallow breaths. Oh, let's put foot on sister or mother's face. Oh, and there's been no complaints from the other. So we're going to sit with these lions a little longer, see what they get up to. While we do that, Jamie's made her way all the way down to the east and is exploring the plains of the cheetah.
Oh, we've made it all the way to the east in the hopes, I feel, this morning. And I have a good feeling about this morning that perhaps we might encounter one of the less often or less frequently seen spotted cats. I chatted to Mike as we came in, and he tells me that Cheetah Plains at the moment is a maze of lion tracks, leopard tracks, and cheetah tracks everywhere. And let us go and see if we can't untangle the maze part and figure out exactly where everything is. There's also lots and lots of hyena tracks, which is unusual for Cheetah Plains. Well, first place to start, naturally, is to go and check all of the water holes. We're just arriving at Three in a Row Pan, the most imaginatively named waterhole in all the area. As you may or may not have guessed, it consists of three pans in a row. Last time I stopped here, there was a marvelous leopard just waiting to surprise us. And perhaps our cheetah would be so kind as to do that for us this morning. As though Three in a Row Pan might be Two in a Row Pan at the moment. Yep, one pan minus water. That one's empty. Okay, see if it's Two in a Row Pan, or perhaps it's just One in a Row Pan. Can't really have one in a row though, can you? I suppose it just becomes one pan. Okay, no, it's Two in a Row Pan. Here we go. Right, last time we stopped here, we stopped to have a break, look around at the pan, and Quarantine was sitting right in front of us, just watching the comings and goings. Unfortunately, it seems as though Quarantine's favourite spot, well, I don't know if it's his favourite spot, it's the one and only time I've ever seen him, it seems as though Quarantine's spot is devoid of Quarantine. He is not here for now. In fact, Three in a Row Pan, or Two in a Row Pan at the moment, is very, very quiet. There's not even a bird around. Let's go investigate further. They did, by the way, the lions that we were tracking, I just spoke to Shanae. That was them following them yesterday evening down that road. They've now crossed onto Mala Mala. Just a little bit of an update for everybody there. We're going to continue on our search along Three in a Row Pan, Two in a Row Pan, and then onto the plains. While we head there, let's go back to James, who has found a place where a bird lives.
That's very cryptic, isn't it? A place where a bird lives. What could that be? It's a nest, everybody. Look over here. Andre is going to show you a blue waxbill's nest, and then I'm going to tell you a story that Herbert's just told us. Now, many of you will know that the blue waxbill, a tiny little blue finch-like bird, has got an association with wasps. And normally around a nest like this, which is not active because it's not the breeding season, will have a paper wasp or hornet's nest around it. Now, the question is, why on earth would it have that? And the answer is, of course, for security. So the wasps will build their nests. Ooh, I've cut myself. I'm just kidding, I'm right. The wasps will come, will have, the wax bills will have the wasps around because the wasps provide security. And so if a snake wants to come and eat the blue wax bill chicks, the wasps will sting it. I'm not sure exactly what the benefit to the wasp is, of course. Now, Herbert reckons that the benefit is that normally inside a wax bill's nest, they will lay 3 or 4 eggs. He says normally only 3 of them will be viable. 1 of them is not viable. And that one that isn't viable, they open up the wax bills just before they fledge. Or in fact, probably while they're still fledging, they'll open it up and leave it at the entrance to the nest. And the wasps will go and eat the yolk and the albumen of that egg. Now, I don't know if that's, I've never read that before. It seems quite viable, because what advantage could there possibly be to the wasps setting up their nests around the wax bill nest? Your other question that Herbert just asked me and I was unable to answer is, how do they communicate? How do they tell each other that this is where they're going to be? And I mean, that's not just across species, that's across almost an entirely different kingdom of creature. So it is a fascinating thing, that. Anyway, that's what goes on there, and I think it's quite a nice theory that Herbert's got, that they leave an egg as a bonus for the security detail that the wasps provide. Let's go this way, Gendry, and then we're going to wind our way down over there. Now, there are some buffalo tracks here. We picked up some male lion tracks. They're not very new, so I don't think we're going to find those, but we might be lucky with the buffalo. Herbert has found something else here, if you can believe it. He's unbelievable. It really is such a joy walking with him because we learn so much. Let's go and find out here. There's a pushed over marula tree. And we'll see if there's anything underneath it or within it. And you can see, I'll just quickly show you one buffalo track. I don't know, Jean-Ro, can you see this one? It's just a very it looks like a large cow track there, everyone. And that's what that is. Big buffalo going that way. A whole herd of them came through here sometime during the course of last night. They're the same tracks I think that Jamie showed you earlier on, right at the beginning of the drive. What have we got here, Herbie? Ah, spiders and scorpions and other spiders. And millipedes, exoskeletons, and that's the violin. No, that's a daddy longleg spider. Amazing. Okay, so let's begin over here. I think let me take a piece of grass. Gendry, let's look at the wolf spider first. It looks like a wolf spider. Can you see it there? You got him there. Gendry? There he is, wolf spider. You can see him attacking the stick and now disappearing. He's gone underneath there. And then over here, the exoskeleton of an olive burrowing scorpion. I'm going to try and pick it up and put it in the sun, but they are very, very delicate. There you go. Don't worry about the blood on my hand, Gendry. It's okay. I'll be all right. So that's the exoskeleton of the olive burrowing scorpion. We find many of them around here. I know that's which species it is because of this habitat and, of course, because of the way it looks. It does have a very thick tail. Gendry just said, keep my hand still. I thought I was keeping it quite still. Are you super zooming? All right, let's put this back down here. There is also a daddy longleg spider. There is also a whole lot of exoskeleton from millipedes under here. We're going to leave them be because Jamie's found a very small, little tiny bib elephant.
He did indeed find a very tiny, small baby elephant. It's not that one. Unfortunately, it was just a little bit too quick for us to put on camera for you, and I can't reposition now to try and get to it. Just because they are going to get very protective over it. I think it's going to come through there, Dave. It's going to pop out there, hopefully, so that we can see it. Oh, that's not it. It's a baby, That's a baby, but it's not the baby that we were looking at earlier. The baby we were looking at earlier is probably only a couple of days old. It is really tiny, wobbly little creature. Utterly adorable. And unfortunately, it has disappeared from view for now, and we won't be able to reposition because we're right in the middle of the elephant herd. And there's another little one about to cross the road. And we'll just wait for this herd of... Oh, it's so tiny, and I just caught a glimpse of it. Sorry, Dave, I'm seeing you bouncing around all over the show. It's at the back. There's Mom going to cross by the marula tree. And little one is hidden behind her. There you go. There you go. Best view of a baby elephant ever. Gives you a rough idea of just how tiny that little thing is. I would say a couple of weeks, maybe. Oh, there we go. We're going to get an open shot. Hello, baby. He's still so fluffy. Too cute. Absolutely stunning. Really, really tiny. I mean, I know it's very difficult for you guys to get a sense of scale, but that is minuscule. The whole enormous herd full of little elephant calves of all ages, right up until the sort of teens, as this one is. And then one straggler that is at the back. We're going to reposition. We're actually going to try and get around them because they're making a very clear beeline for the other road. So let's go do that now. Hopefully we can get there a little bit ahead of them so that we don't startle them. And then maybe we'll get another view of that little one because it's adorable. And no day is complete. No safari experience is complete without a little bit of time spent with elephants, in my opinion. And just by the way, an update for you. The Karula and her cubs are safe and sound south of our boundary. So they moved south after the incident this morning with the hyena. They've disappeared to the south. And they're both cubs are present and accounted for and safe. Just a comforting update for you all. If you were concerned, as I'm sure you were. Come on, Rusty, let's try and be a bit quieter. Here we go. They're going to come to us, which is perfect. That's exactly what we want. I'm going to try and put us in the best possible position. It is into the sun, but it is in line with where they are coming through. Ah, we all stopped to feed now. Hey, look at this, tuskless elephant. Let's go fractionally forward so I can actually get the sun on the other side of them. And then we have a better view of as they start to walk towards us. But this elephant doesn't have any tusks. Let the engine run for a bit. Oh, tuskless elephants, a naturally occurring phenomenon, although it has been artificially selected for due to human interference, but it is a naturally occurring genetic abnormality. It occurs, it occurs in about 4% of elephants throughout the world naturally. That percentage has been boosted right up to around 10, even up into places in Zambia, up to about 30% of elephants now born without tusks. And that, of course, is due to tremendous amounts of poaching in those sorts of areas. And this is actually a tuskless female, which we see. There's a herd with two tuskless females, and I'm wondering if it's not this one. Impossible for us to tell at this point. And then in complete contrast to our elephant without tusks, just have a look at this little youngster that's come through behind her. And for his size, his tusks are absolutely enormous for his age. Look at that. You'll see when he walks into the open, you'll get an idea of just how disproportionately large his tusks seem. And now that, when he grows up, that bull, and it's very clearly a bull, judging by the thickness of those tusks, that little bull is going to be one to watch. He might have monster tusks if he doesn't break them off. Because he's young. I would say he's under 10 years old. Maybe not. Maybe not quite, maybe just around 10 years old. A complete contrast to our tuskless female. And I was so hoping our elephants were going to keep coming in this direction. But they've all stopped in the thick bush willow woodland. I was hoping they were going to go for a drink at Cheetah Plains Pan. I've just realized that Cheetah Plains Pan doesn't actually have any water anymore. And good morning to Michael. We saw that little elephant calf racing away from us and it was very, very fluffy. And Michael wants to know why that is. Why are elephant calves born so fluffy with all that fluff around their heads? Michael, first of all, our Benjamin Button elephant, our little calf that's been nicknamed Benji, he's the exception rather than the rule. He looks as though, as James said, he actually looks as though he's got implants. He's had hair implants put in. The most ridiculous looking thing. That's unusual, but all baby elephants are born with extra levels of fluff. I don't know the exact reason behind that. I mean, I think it's possibly just that they have roughly the amount of hair as the adults do, but because they're smaller, it looks like they're fluffier. But I think it's probably to do with insulation as well. The tiny little ones losing their body heat, as any small animal does. A small animal loses body heat faster than a large animal does. So it might be for insulation, but I have to be 100% honest with you. I don't fully know why elephants are born so much fluffier than their adult counterparts. I mean, the leopard cubs are, the lion cubs are, everything's a bit fluffier when it's born. But I don't know why that might be the case with elephants. Excuse me. I'm just watching them, trying to figure out exactly where they're going to go. Unfortunately, they've all pretty much disappeared into the tree line. I don't think I've got a view of any of them at the moment. And they've just decided to stop there. So while we search for a different view, or maybe even not search for a different view, maybe wait patiently for them to move out into the open, let's go back across to Brent and his sleepy lions.
Not much has changed here. Now you can see as it's got warmer, the one lioness has opened her legs, exposing that white belly. Sorry, my head's in the way, to try release some heat. Other than that, there's been absolutely no movement. I was hoping they were going to get up and possibly move into the shade, but well, the opening of the legs is a sign that she's starting to get warm, so she might move into the shade shortly. I'm just going to reposition again a little bit because the male, we can have a look, he's flat as well, but the sun is creeping up on him, so he might get up to move shortly. Look at that. Oh, it looks like he's dreaming. Dreaming of buffalo, no doubt. Or is he dreaming of Inkahuma lionesses? There isn't anything out in the African bush that I've ever experienced that can sleep quite like a lion can. Leopards sleep heavily, but not to the same degree. Male lion definitely takes the cake. Very little to worry about while you're having a nap, apart from maybe an elephant. The epitome of a flat cat. A dreaming flat cat. Almost half expect to see his legs start scurrying as he's chasing something through the bush. But his eyes twitching and his mouth are twitching. Okay, let's try a reposition. Then notice how I let the engine run, no movement whatsoever. quickly across to the other vehicle, or not sure what.
Look at what we have here. How very fascinating. Oh, by the way, I was wrong about Cheetah Plains Pan having no water, because it does indeed have water. We've got a bird of prey that I think might be coming across to have a drink. I don't want to get any closer, and it's difficult in this light. The sun is right behind us, or behind the bird, rather. But I don't want to sneak any closer, but I would really curiously like to know what this bird is up to. Sorry about the heat waves coming up from the bonnet as well. I'm not sure whether you are seeing that as clearly as I am, but it's sort of playing havoc slightly with the images. What are you up to, Eagle? Looks like a tawny from what I can see of it. You guys have got a slightly clearer view. You are welcome to correct me. And it appears to be contemplating its navel at present. Not, of course, that birds really have navels. What are you up to? I wonder if it's killed something. And it's just taking a quick break before it starts to feed. It keeps looking down at its feet. But it's also keeping an eye on us, a little bit nervous at our presence here as well. Look at that incredible hooked beak. Might not be able to see it terribly clearly, but you can get an idea of the shape and the power of that bull. Wonder if it hasn't killed something. We've just got the wrong angle for a view, hidden behind the wall. I think it might be worth risking. Shifting around ever so slightly, it'll change the angle. It'll also make the sun a bit easier, because at the moment we are, both Dave and myself, are a bit blinded by it. It's very bright out here. Perhaps let's try and reposition. Now that you've seen it, let's see if we can't figure out what it's up to. The engine run a little bit. And just scoot around. It's okay, birdie. Please don't fly. Please don't fly. It's okay. It's okay. It's okay. Okay, it definitely doesn't have a kill. This is close as I'm prepared to go. I think if we go any closer, it's going to go. There you go. Feathered all the way down to the legs. That immediately tells you that you are dealing with an eagle, a true eagle, rather than any other bird of prey, but we could tell that straight away from the size of this particular bird. It's tall and come almost all the way up to my knee. What is there? What is so fascinating at your feet? This is most bemusing. Might be down here to look for termites, and birds of prey not necessarily stuck on feeding on just things like rodents and frogs and birds. They will also catch insects. 100% why our feathered friend is grounded for now. Not even particularly windy. It is just phenomenally bright. Trying to see if there's another bird of prey around us. Perhaps might give us a hint. Maybe he's just come to sunbathe. Makes sense. I was just saying to Dave that the temperature feels like it's dropped ever so slightly, so perhaps our bird has come down to the ground for a bit of shelter from the wind and some warm sun to heat up after a very chilly evening. Margaret, I agree. I also think it's a tawny eagle. You guys will be able to see a little bit more clearly than I can, just in terms of the size of the screen and also the fact that the sun's incredibly bright. Oh, it was a one-legged eagle until now. Popped his other foot down. What has it got? Yes, that's your foot. That's your feet, actually. There's two of them. Oh, it's given us such a marvellous view of its feet there before going back onto one leg. And that's a very common raptor pose. They love to stand on one leg. Very, very common to see it. And I remember when I was first training, a trainer of mine had everybody looking up a one-legged bird, except me. Well, he had every, let's put it this way, he had every student who's not South African looking through the bird book to try and find the one-legged eagle. Oh, I have a good scratch. But Margaret, yes, I agree, it looks like a tawny from my perspective. Oh, big yawn. Might be a juvenile, which is why it's got the mottled colouring to it. So we've got a bird seemingly fascinated by its feet, standing on one leg in the sun in an open area, not really doing much except for sunbathing. I think the conclusion is that this is just enjoying a good morning to warm up. Yep, your feet's still there, don't worry. It's okay. Interesting. Still looking from side to side. Probably making sure that nothing's sneaking up on it. Probably feels incredibly vulnerable down on the ground like this. We are very far away. We are very zoomed in. So every time I move the car, it that causes that jumping movement. That one was Dave, though.
Yes,
I'm not taking the blame for that one. I'm usually quite still. Okay. While I try and figure out what this bird is up to, I'm not quite sure. I think Dave and I will probably move on. Let's go over to James, who's found one of my least favourite creatures.
Well, look at this, everybody. Fossicking about in the dirt, scrabbling in the obese mess that they find themselves. Two of the world's most despised creatures, as Jamie said. Ticks! Look at the size of these ticks. They are engorged with blood. They have sucked the blood of the buffalo on whose tracks we are walking now. And they are deeply vile. Let me pick one up for you. Now, a tick is an arachnid. See, it's got eight legs. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. And two pedipalps in the front, in much the same way that a spider does. This thing started life as no more than a pinprick, and it is now an enormous and disgustingly engorged animal. It is unable to move anymore because it is so fat, and as far as I understand it, it's come to the end of its life cycle, and it's now going to probably lay eggs and then die, thoroughly satisfied with its efforts at eating blood from buffalo. Isn't it vile? Ugh. What do you think, Jandre? I'd like to find one of those walking around on you. And there you can see its head in the sun. Absolutely astounding. Anyway, we're carrying on these buffalo tracks. And we are going to see if we can find them before the end of the show. I don't think we're going to. Looks like they were chased down here by lions. So we're probably going to turn towards the front. Herb's got something over there. Let's go and have a look. I'm going to leave these ticks over here. Just come over here, Jandre, if you don't mind. I've picked this other stick up, everyone, because I quite like it. And I think it's going to be a good stick. Once I've chopped it up a little, Herbie's found something quickly here, and then we'll send you back to Brent or Jamie, I'm not sure whom. Sorry, Jandre, I know this is quite fast for you. What have we got, Herb?
It's a scorpion.
It's a scorpion. Tiny scorpion, everybody. It's underneath this little piece of bark here. Sorry. Oh my. Look at that. Can you see it, Jandre? It's just there. in front of my finger. Can you see it there? It's a tiny, tiny little scorpion, about half a centimeter long. Have you got him? Look how tiny he is. I don't know what kind of scorpion that is. It's not one of those olive burrowing scorpions, everyone. And I can tell that because the pincers are too fat and the tail is too thin and the colour is wrong. It's not olive. I suspect it's one of those Pisticanthus scorpions, but I'm not sure. Isn't that amazing? Minute. I'll put my finger back into the shot there. It's probably, well, with its tail, it's probably about a centimetre long. Isn't that fantastic? Just living under the log here. We'll cover him up again now. Okay, let's go back to Brenty and the lions. We'll continue probably heading, we'll slowly make our way back towards home now. See you just now.
Now, the one lioness, the one who had... No, it wasn't. It's not the one who had her legs open. The one who had her legs open was Amber Eyes. The other lioness has got up and she's moved and she's lying next to her sister. And now she has definite suckle marks. So this one has cubs. So that pretty much confirms what we think, that three of the Inkahumas have cubs at the moment. So we've only seen two sets. So there's still a third set to find. Isn't that exciting? Now where her den site is, oof, only she knows. Now, we're not going to stay here for too much longer. I don't think the lions are going to move at all unless something happens to stumble onto them. But at the moment, it looks like they're going to be snoozing in this area and should be here on the sunset safari. Now, Miriam's wondering what is the purpose of the black stripe on the back of a lion's ears. Now, it's a very important thing, actually, Miriam. It's a following mechanism for cubs, like the black tip to the tail. It's also a visual indicator while hunting. And there's some very interesting research being done on non-verbal communication between social predators when they hunt. And it looks like there's quite a lot of information that's relayed by movement of the ears while the lions are hunting. So very, very interesting stuff. Very sort of groundbreaking when it comes to predator behavior. And there's a very, very well-known lion guy or lion scientist by the name of Craig Packer who's heading that research at the moment. I've been fortunate enough to work with him on a few projects, so very, very interesting, and I can't wait for the outcome of that study. It is going to be a while yet, though. Oh, it looks like Mister's popped his head up. Let's have a look. Hopefully he doesn't pop it down before we swing around towards him. How's that, Brian? Here we go. Well, he had popped his head up. And possibly checking to see if the lioness is trying to sneak away while he was snoozing. Oh, there, that head gets heavy again. Back onto his foreleg. I'm quite sure that these lions are going to be in the exact same spot come sunset safari, and I don't think we're going to get too much movement, but it's nice to confirm that the third lioness is indeed suckling. So that means there's three sets of Inkahuma cubs. We've only found two, so it could be very, very exciting in the next while. And I wonder if she's also got three cubs, or does she have two, or does she have one, or does she even have four? A record in the wild is six cubs to a single lioness, but that is incredibly unusual. Even three is quite a lot, the sort of norm is two. I think we're going to let these lions doze off and head towards some of the water holes and see if we can find some general game. Oh, okay, legs are opening. I mean, she's starting to get hot, so she might get up and move to the other girls in the shade. Now, April's wondering, what are the chances or the likelihood of the other set of cubs being close by? Well, it's quite good. All three lionesses have been using the little drainage systems on Juma. I mean, all two of them so far, so it's a strong possibility that she could also be using one of these little drainage systems on Juma. So very exciting. Oh, not that hot yet. Legs are closed again. And the rest of the kitty cats are faster doo-doo. And I think Brian and I have spent sufficient time warming our bones in the sun. So we're going to leave these lions and see, as I said, make our way to a waterhole. This time of day, as it starts getting warm, quite often things like zebra and wildebeest and maybe even some buffalo will be heading towards the waterholes. So let's go have a look. Okay, we're going to remove ourselves from here. One last look at the big boy. He has now decided the ground's a better pillow than his paw. Oh, so peaceful. Okay, kiddies. Enjoy your snooze. As I said, they're going to be very close to here come sunset safari, so I think they are quite hungry, so there's a good chance they might hunt. How did we get ourselves in here, Brian? Oh, me neither. We must have been quite clever. Looks like there's a wall behind us. Oh, we'll have to go this way then. Yes. We came through along the elephant path. Big game trail here. Aha! I think we went through here. Oh no, we went through there. Oh, we'll go through here this time. Okay, Brian? Brian just avoiding the very, very sharp hooked thorns of the knobthorn tree. Got to be on that game drive radio with yours quickly. Standing by. Yours, I'm leaving now. I'm leaving tax in here, so you're more than welcome to make your way. So, Ramey is wondering, what is the best advice that my dad has given me about the bush? Ooh, that's a difficult question, Ramey. I'd say it's, rather than advice, it's been time spent. And in particular, probably time spent with elephants and getting to learn the little nuances in their behavior. Especially in the area I grew up in Botswana. And during this time of the year, we could have 20 to 25,000 elephants in 200,000 hectares. So just driving between the two camps, which was about 40 kilometers, you could see 2,000 elephants, and a lot of those elephants weren't used to cars. So you have to be quite careful and really know your elephant behavior well, especially in the early days when the elephants were really not used to cars and used to charge quite a lot. So I think just time spent with elephants. Now, I do believe to a degree that some people can read animals better than others. What did you see in Brian? Oh, I thought you looked up and saw something there. So I said some people can read animals better than others, but even then, like any natural skill, the more you work at it, the better you get at it. So I'd say probably all the time spent and teaching me how to read elephants in particular, but all the animals. So not really advice. Advice, possibly, trust your gut. Your gut's seldom wrong, especially when it comes to a bit of a hairy situation. If gut says shout and bang the car, shout and bang the car. If gut says keep quiet, it's okay. It's
to us. Oopsie daisy, well it seems as though Brent has disappeared off your screens, but never fear, we're still around, we're still available, and we're still on Cheetah Plains. And we're about to get to the open part of Cheetah Plains actually very, very shortly. Unfortunately, no matter where I went, I couldn't get you another view of those elephants, so Dave and myself moved on for now. We've gone to go investigate claims that a cheetah have been wandering through this area. I found a really interesting track, but I'm hesitant. I can't confirm it 100% because it had been driven over, or it had been driven right next to, so I can't fully clarify. But I think I found a brown hyena track. And the reason I say that, there's a vast difference between a spotted hyena track and a brown hyena track. And that is that for brown hyena, the track of their back foot is about less than half the size of their front foot. It is tiny. There's a massive, massive size difference between its front track and its back track. Whereas with spotted hyena, that difference is not as pronounced. I've seen lots of brown hyena tracks in the past. This one was so in such thick sand, and it had been driven next to, that I wasn't 100% sure, not confident enough to actually show you or give it to you as an example. But I think it is something really worth following up on Cheetah Plains in the future, keeping an eye out for. Because now that I think about it, it makes absolute sense. We've got the boundary of Kruger right here. We know that there's a brown hyena in the Kruger National Park. And the fact that they might be coming onto Cheetah Plains for a visit is something very exciting indeed. And what's even more exciting about it is if I am right, I'm not 100% sure that I am, but I think I might be. If I am right, brown hyenas often walk regular pathways. So it'll be worth one evening before, I mean, we always start to head further west towards the end of the sunset safari, but it might be worth staying out that little bit extra at the end of a sunset safari one day and just checking that area around Buffalo Pan. Because who knows, we might have a marvelous surprise. And I think, as far as I know, there's only one brown hyena that has ever been seen on these live drives before. So it is something that would be incredibly exciting. Definitely something I would love to be able to share with you. So let's keep our fingers crossed that I am right. Okay, cheetah. And again, a very good morning to Michael on the Sunrise Safari, speaking about cheetah and hoping that they might pop out in front of us. I haven't seen any tracks, but I am checking very carefully. Michael, is there the possibility or the prospect of cheetah cubs in our future? Absolutely there is. Now, it's a difficult one in that female cheetah are almost, their home ranges are so enormous, so as for them to be almost to be considered nomadic. But when they do have cubs, then they do settle into one area in particular. Now, since these boys are often here, there's a chance that she could mate with them and then stay in the area. Let's wave hello to Mala Mala. And maybe. He doesn't look like he's rushing anywhere, so we won't be following him. So there is a chance. There is always a chance that we could see cheetah cubs, and that would be, let me tell you something, it would make Viam so happy. I think it would be the best. I mean, it would make all of us happy. You can imagine how wonderful that would be. But Viam in particular has a thing about cheetah cubs. He is dying to see them on our live safaris. This has become awkward now. I'm going to veer off to the right. This has just got too awkward for me. This is just really socially awkward situation. When driving two parallel roads at the same speed, it's like when you say goodbye to somebody and then you both walk off in the same direction and then it just becomes awkward. That's what that was. That whole situation was just awkward. We'll move on. He doesn't look like he knows something I don't. Over to Brent, who's got a rare animal. Oh, dog. I'm ready.
And it is a rare animal we've been seeing more of, and I'm going to stop where we can see them. They're a little bit skittish. How's that, Brian? Not great. Oh, there's a few around. There we go. There we go. There's a big boy at the back. Oh, off they disappear. It's quite a big troop, I'd say. Easily 25, 30, maybe even a few more of the chacma baboon. Now, of all the animals out here, let me go back a bit. Of the carnivore slash omnivore. Oh, they're going to disappear into the tree line. One last look at that big boy. There he is. And they have longer canines than a male lion, can you believe it? Obviously not as thick, but longer. We'll try to see if we can get... I don't think we're going to get any closer to them, unfortunately. They are a bit skittish. They don't spend too much time on Juma, and with the drought, it's forcing them to move into bigger areas to forage, to make sure they get enough food. Yell if you get a gap there, Brian. I think they're moving into the tree line towards the little river system. Ooh! Roller wars. Lilac-breasted rollers attacking purple roller. So there's the lilac-breasted roller coming in to attack the purple who's sitting on the branch. Now, of course, they do compete for the similar food source. And we do have a pair of purple rollers and a pair of lilac-breasted rollers on quarantine. And let's try to get a bit closer to the purple. Oh, and the lilac. Now the purple's bigger than the lilac. I'm just gonna not drive straight at them so they don't fly away. Okay. Now, if we stick on the purple, I think it's going to about to be bombarded by the lilac. Oh, the lilac's all over us, all around us. The purple roller is sitting on the branch there. You see him, Brian? If you in the tree itself, and I think he's about to get bombed. So there we go, a little bit higher. There we go. If you center screen now, so there's the purple roller. Sitting there just trying to bask in the sun, and it's being harassed by a pair of lilac breasted rollers. Well, you can hear the purple rollers call. Oh, it sounds like a little frog. Now the lilacs have stopped in the tree behind it, but we're just gonna stick on the purple to see if those lilacs come back for another attack. So roller wars on quarantine. There we go, the purple's calling. Now, as he flies, yes, there they come. Here comes the lilac after him. The purple's escaped. The lilacs are shouting from joy from the tree that the purple was previously in. Is that a lilac following the purple? Oh no, it's outside, sorry. On the far left of the third tree, the one the purple roller was in, there's the lilac-breasted roller. So that purple roller found a spot where it could sit with a branch above it to keep the lilacs from harassing it, and then once they gave him a bit of space, he moved away from them. Gorgeous birds, both the purple and the lilac-breasted roller. Did he catch something? Incredible camera work. Oh, now the purple's attacking. Oh, the other purple came on the offensive. Let's go forward a little bit. So the second purple roller, there we go. It came and just chased the lilacs. Now the lilacs are bombing the purple. It's all happening here on quarantine as the roller wars continue. Here we go. There's the... Okay, if we come down a bit, Brian, there's that little marula. There we go. There's the purple roller, the second purple roller. As that other roller looked like it dived for an insect, the second purple roller came out and almost had a mid-air collision with it. A sneak attack. And the lilac-breasted rollers are not sounding too happy. You can hear the... Maybe the purple rollers, jealous of the lilac-breasted rollers' gorgeous breast colour. But I think not. I think it's more of a competition for available food resources. Oh, it looks like maybe that lilac might have a nest here as well. And that could be the reason for all of the commotion. I'm just going to move forward to see if there's a nest hole there. Roller's flown, but it does look like they could. It's a very good spot for a lilac-breasted roller to have a nest. There's a hole in the cavity of that little apple leaf or rain tree, and there could be a nest, and that could be why the lilac-breasted rollers are so aggressive around this particular set of trees. Wasn't that fascinating? Roller wars. Now, it seems as we start moving, they start again. I'll try to get a bit closer to the purple roller. That's letting us get this close. They are brilliantly beautiful birds. You can see that big beak, bigger than the lilac-breasted rollers. And one of the other very diagnostic features, apart from the color and the size, is that the purple roller lacks rackets. Now, think about a tennis racket. When you look at a lilac-breasted roller, it's got long tail feathers with a round bobble on the end that looks a bit, actually probably not like a tennis racket, but more like a badminton racket. So and when you call birds who have those very specific long tail feathers, you do call them rackets. And there's another species of roller that we don't get here that's actually called a racket-tailed roller. And it's, I think, my favorite of the roller species we get in southern Africa. Oh, Brian spotted the lilac-breasted on top of a little cluster leaf. And you can see those long rackets sticking out. It seems like there's a standoff now between the rollers. Let's leave the rollers to the roller wars of quarantine, and the killer bees are going to say a good morning, and we won't be out this evening. There's the thumb. It'll be the James and James and Jamie will be out, and hopefully there will be lots of lions around lion cubs. And I know you heard Karula has a kill to the south, so unfortunately she might not be around, but maybe another leopard will make an appearance. So from the killer bees, adieu.
We're not far from Brent, he's just up around the corner there, and we're sitting on quarantine clearings enjoying the warmth of the sun. It's actually going to be quite hot today, which of course is quite unusual for this time of the year. Just look at these beautiful seeds. You see them, Jandre? Glowing pale syrupy gold. Isn't that nice? I don't know what they're from. They're not from a grass, they're from some sort of plant out here. But they'll be put to the wind as the August winds start, and they shall grow anew later on. And then I just wanted to show you one other glass piece of grass, also that's going to be spread by the wind, and this is a three-awn grass. I'm not sure exactly which one. Right, that's going to be it from us today. Thank you for joining us on our bushwalk. It's been wonderful fun. Thank you, Jandre, for taking the abuse and for all your efforts today. He did squash a tick earlier on. It was very disgusting. We will see you this afternoon at 3 o'clock. Until then, go and enjoy the last few minutes with Jamie. Bye-bye.
Oh, enjoy our last few moments on Cheetah Plains for now, before the end of the sunrise safari. Picked up on all of the lion tracks that have moved through this area. But I think that they are the lions that they've since found on Mala Mala, the Styx, or around Mala Mala region, the Styx and a couple of the Birminghams. No cheetah today, and Dave, or a pangolin actually. Every time I come to Cheetah Plains with you, you never find me a pangolin.
Next time.
Dave. Next time, okay. We'll see. Promises, promises. Dave, of course, responsible for spotting the one and only pangolin in a very, very long time that any of us have seen. A scaly anteater, which is exceptionally rare to see, and it's a terribly tall order for me to demand a repetition of Dave's spotting skills. Perhaps almost unfair, but I'm going to maintain that it is a show of favoritism if he does not present us all with equal opportunities. We are going to slow down ever so slightly before we get to the end of our sunrise safari. The reason I say that is because just ahead of me, oopsie, that stick nearly flew up and hit Dave in the head. You gotta be careful about where you drive over in terms of the sticks in the sun. If you hit it at the wrong angle, you're gonna fling it up and swing it into the car, which I've done before, multiple times. And Dave had a very lucky escape. Dave, that's what will happen to you if you don't find me a pangolin next time on Cheetah Plains. Okay, just checking. Just making sure. We will have to follow up this afternoon on the sunset safari, see if those lions decide to stir themselves, and whether or not the lioness feeding her cubs might decide to head across. I'm sad that the Queen of Juma crossed south, but you never know, she might return to us in due course, perhaps this afternoon. I must find out from the other guides if she has a kill, and I will update you all on that subject in a couple of hours. Alright, so we've reached the end of our sunrise safari. Thank you, Dave, for all of your fantastic camera work as always, as well as to Louise. Enormous amount of nonsense, and most importantly, thank you to all of you watching across the globe. I hope you have enjoyed the sunrise safari. It's lovely to hear some new names as well as our regular names. Not that it's not lovely to hear regular names, but it's lovely to hear some new names as well. Have a fantastic day. We will catch you on the Sunset Safari in a few hours.